Coming up on episode 23 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
This is Steve Sansweet from Rancho Obi-Wan, and I am skywalking through Neverland.
And Steve, you also hit it big last week when you were the $2,000 Jeopardy answer. Which Muppet do you think you're most like?
And the Muppet.
And it's part of the genius of who the Muppets are.
Waka waka.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
There it is. Listen.
A billion years in the making.
Off to Neverland.
What do you know?
You'll laugh. You'll cry. You'll kiss $3 goodbye.
Hey, everyone. Welcome back, and thank you once again for joining us on
Skywalking Through Neverland.
This is Richard, and next to me over here is my sweetie, Sarah.
That's right. I'm also known as Jedi Tink, and we are skywalking through Neverland together. We cover Star Wars, Disney, and pop culture fandom. You know, the stuff that surrounds us, penetrates us, and binds us all together as instantaneous friends.
Very well said. This week, we had a great conversation with Mr. Star Wars collector, Guinness Book of World Records holder, and Jeopardy answer himself.
Who's that?
Mr. Steven Sansweet. We've been looking forward to this for so long, we finally got him.
Yay.
Now, he's got a lot of great stuff coming up, like eBay auctions, and he answers a question that's been on my mind since 1978 about the original action figures. I've asked so many people, and no one ever knew. So I had to squeeze that question in there, and he answered it.
Yay. Well, also now, it's time to play the music.
It's time to light the lights.
It's time to talk to Skywalking Through Neverland's creative consultant,
Mark Ogushowitz, on his favorite subject,
the Muppets.
He is a Muppet fanatic the way you are, Sarah, about Disney, and I am about Star Wars. Mm-hmm. He is just a huge Muppet fan.
We also recap Billy Dee Williams' Dancing with the Stars performance and have our countdown with some news about Star Wars weekends.
And of course, we always have lots, lots more to share with you.
Episodes are action-packed.
But first, we'd like to congratulate the winners of the Behind the Voice Actors Awards, which were announced on March the 19th.
James Arnold Taylor.
He won as Obi-Wan in the category of Best Male Lead Vocal Performance in a TV Series Action Drama.
And he was the people's choice.
To me, that's an even higher honor than just getting one by the committee, because this is the people's choice award.
I think so, too.
Nika Futterman won as Asajj Ventress.
Nice. She won the Best Female Vocal Performance in a TV Series in a Supporting Role, Action Drama. Also a People's Choice.
We had met Nika Futterman at the Clone Wars screening for the Night Sisters trilogy in Hollywood a couple of years ago. And I asked her to say my name as Asajj Ventress.
Uh-huh.
And she said it in a... It gave me chills. To hear Asajj Ventress say your name, that's never a good thing.
Too bad we didn't have our Zoom recorder then.
Yeah, or a podcast. Ian Abercrombie won as Darth Sidious for the Best Male Vocal Performance in a TV Series and a Guest Role Action or Drama. He was an official winner.
Now, did we meet him too?
No, and sadly he passed away not too long ago. That's why they've had Tim Curry...
Gotcha.
Pick up the role as Darth Sidious and Palpatine.
Okay. This is exciting. Ariel Winter won as Sophia the First. She got the Best Female Vocal Performance in a TV Series for Children's Educational.
Sarah's a big viewer of Sophia the First.
Yeah. So that was exciting. Now this news comes to us thanks to Donald Wicks, because he posted this story on our timeline on Facebook.
Thank you, Donald. Now, how many times did you hear this song this week?
Let it go, let it go. I am one with the wind and sky.
If you're like us, then you heard it a million times. And judging by the 3.2 million discs Disney sold in one day. Let's say that again. 3.2 million discs in one day.
Wow.
Then you also just saw Frozen on DVD, Blu-ray, or digital download.
Now, is that 3.2 million movie discs?
Yeah, but let's broaden this out a little more.
Okay.
It also includes the pre-sales, which have been going on since November.
Oh.
So it's one day, but I'm sure most of that was bought opening day on March 18th.
Including us.
Yes. And according to Amazon, Frozen has become the strongest selling home entertainment title in history.
Really?
History. Do you know how far back history goes?
Forever. For home entertainment? Since the 80s?
Disney took a very unusual step with all of this, and they offered the film for digital download. And wait for it, they let it go onto iTunes. Did you hear that? Did you get that?
I got it. I see what you did there.
Yeah, they let it go onto iTunes.
Hashtag see what I did there.
Nice. So they let it go on iTunes and other streaming services while the film was still in theaters and still in the box office top 10.
Wow.
That's a brave move.
I think so.
And now, the moment we've been waiting for. Our conversation with Steven Sansweet.
Be our guest, be our guest. Put our service to the test. Tie your napkin on your cherry and we'll provide the rest. Soup is your hot hors d'oeuvres.
We are lucky enough to have Mr. Steve Sansweet on our show today. He is the owner of a pretty sizable Star Wars collection, which is housed up in Northern California in a chicken barn he converted into Rancho Obi-Wan. And if this is something you want to dispute, then take it up with the Guinness Book of World Records, since he was just entered into the 2014 edition as having the world's largest collection of Star Wars memorabilia.
Wow, amazing. And Steve, you also hit it big last week when you were the $2,000 Jeopardy answer.
Well, hi, guys. Yes, that was rather strange. In fact, I've just written a blog about it, which will run on StarWars.com. To be famous for something you had nothing to do with, at least directly, is a little weird. But yeah, I sitting here at my computer and get an email from my nephew and says, "Hey, Unc, you were just an answer on Jeopardy." And what? Yeah, that's pretty funny. Pretty funny.
Well, first the Guinness Book of World Records, then Jeopardy. What's next?
They were tied together since the category was Guinness Records 2014. So,
perfect.
But it was the double Jeopardy, and it was the highest point value. So, yeah, I felt good about that.
And for any of those listeners who was not fortunate enough to see this, the answer was Steve Sansweet, owner of a 300,000-item Star Wars collection, got a job at this company, now part of Disney. Answer or question?
What is Lucasfilm?
What is Lucasfilm?
You know, if he had said, "What is Lucasfilms?" like so many people do, he probably would have been declared wrong because he mispronounced some actress's last name and it was declared wrong.
Ooh.
Yeah. Well, because of you, that gentleman just got $2,000.
Right. And then he zeroed out the next day and left the show after winning 11 straight shows.
Oh, wow.
Well, we'll just focus on the good part then.
Okay.
Now, you recently put up a bunch of your duplicate collectibles on eBay and your Rancho Obi-Thon to raise money to support Rancho Obi-Wan. How is that going?
Well, we actually did two. We started the Rancho Obi-Thon, which was a one-week eBay auction of things that had been donated to us mainly by good friends who are artists and either prints or original art. A nice piece from Gentle Giant, and then we also started at the same time something that is continuing called Rancho Obi-Wan Dupe Deals, and this is in fact duplicates of things that I mostly accidentally bought two of, and got half a barn full of that stuff over all of these years, and so
guilty.
That, continue. So under the Rancho Obi-Wan charity store, we've got a lot of things listed, buy it now, and, you know, bidding, and that will continue indefinitely.
Oh, great.
So the Rancho Obi-Thon did very well, and we're still sort of totaling up all of that, but well over $15,000 was raised in that 1 week auction, and we are thrilled with that. And yeah, our plan is to continue doing that twice a year. Once a year would be our big annual fundraising gala. Last year the theme was the World Record Night. And we've already announced hold the date for September 20th for this year's in-person gala. And then in the springtime, we will have the Rancho Obi-Thon. So, you know, it takes a lot of money to keep a nonprofit running. And these are a couple of ways that we can do that.
What kind of items were your biggest sellers?
On the Rancho Obi-Thon, art is always a big seller, and one of the best sellers was an incredibly beautiful poster that Adam Hughes had done for Celebration. It was Leia in her Jabba's slave outfit. And it was a tour of planets, and she was aboard the sail barge. And it's just a long, narrow piece, and I've seen people frame it. And Adam did a really, really cool remark in at the bottom, you know, in black pen. And that went well. We had some problems with the eBay choice on our iconic Dave Filoni Clone Wars hat signed by Dave. And
what happened there?
Yeah. We'll have to ask them. I don't know. They had problems with where the word Star Wars was in the title. And we changed it. And they said, well, yeah, you'll probably be okay with that. And then they took it down again a day before. So we finished that off on Sunday. And we had an email auction, and that sold. So, huh. You know, we're very happy, and we're very appreciative to the people who bid, and also to the people who donated these items to us. And it's great. It really is.
And how often will you put up any kind of new items or your duplicate items?
Dupe items will just continue until, you know, I would think that the Rancho Obi-Wan store will be in operation for a while. We don't want to overload it. Yeah, but there'll be lots of things there. There'll be buy it now things. There'll be best offer things, and there will be things to bid on. So that will constantly be refreshed. What the money we raise goes for is for professional expenses, for security, for utilities, which is when you light a 9,000 square foot museum and either cool it or heat it. The bills are shocking. And we also use it as part of our community outreach program to help us fund tours for school kids and classes. And we also give tours to other charities to auction off so they can raise money. So there are lots of parts to that maintenance. We're in the process of adding a 900 square foot room that was in a falling down back barn that literally the barn would have collapsed in another year or two, and we're fixing up the roof on that. So yeah, there are, believe me, there are many more things that to spend money on than we have the money to spend, but it's all good, and we always appreciate help from fellow fans and from licensees and others.
But do any other fan community groups do this kind of charity work? I've never heard of anyone else but the Star Wars community.
You know what? The Star Wars community, as all three of us know, is really unique. And unique is an overused word, but it is unique. I have never scene, and there has never been, in my view, a community of fans worldwide that does as much good for other people as Star Wars fans. We know about some of the organized groups like the 501st and the Rebel Legion and the Mando Mercs, raising money for charities, doing visits to kids' hospital wards, and doing things internally. You know, if somebody is ill, somebody has a baby who's born with a mysterious disease. Mm-hmm. And I mean, the 501st, a couple of years ago, twice within the space of 12 months, one member contributed a kidney to another member that they didn't even know. And it happened twice.
Oh,
and
my goodness.
That's, I mean, you're giving the gift of life to somebody. And
yeah.
Star Wars fandom is, it's just wonderful to be part of. And it's unlike, as I said, unlike any other. And it's been around a long time. And I think its strength is just growing as we approach the first of a whole bunch of new Star Wars movies.
Now, Richard and I were excited to buy a membership a couple years ago, and we took the tour to Rancho Obi-Wan.
And then we hooked you and made you volunteer.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, at Celebration 6, the best time I had at the convention was volunteering for Rancho Obi-Wan. So amazing.
You know what? There are a lot of people, and not just Rancho Obi-Wan, but there's so many people who say, I go to conventions and the most fun I have is being a volunteer because I want to be
part
behind
of
the scenes and where, you know, I just don't want to spend 8 hours just walking around and looking at dealers or sitting in on every panel. Or it's fun to spend some time at least volunteering. You get a great sense of community, and that's what Star Wars fandom is all about.
On Skywalking Through Neverland, we always have a countdown to Celebration, and some people will email us and say, hey, what kind of things should we look forward to? And I tell them, if you've already been to a Celebration, great, but try volunteering either at Rancho Obi-Wan or Official Picks, just so you can see what goes on behind the scenes and meet more people.
I agree. Volunteering is a lot of fun.
Yeah, because these big conventions just take so much to put on, and it's just so gratifying to become part of that and just help out with everything that we can. The only thing that I wouldn't do as a volunteer when I was volunteering for Official Picks, they wanted all the volunteers to shred the remaining Star Wars autographed pictures.
I've seen that happen, and it is heartbreaking.
that's what I think.
Richard was asked to do that, yeah. And he put his hands up. He's like, I can't do that.
Don't tell Ann Newman, but I think she was the one who asked me to shred up all these pictures, and I walked away. I couldn't do
it. They have to do that under their contract, and these pictures are only available, and because that's what they promise, these pictures are only available with that particular imprint at that particular event. Now, I'm not sure if that's still the case the last two times, or whether it was just the Official Picks logo. So I don't know. It just seems like a terrible waste.
Oh, it was. That's why it was heartbreaking. Now, aside from tours, what else do you do there at Rancho Obi-Wan?
We have fun. we're getting more into the event business. And so we've had two major parties here where we've had 150 or more people, but we're talking about anything from a business lunch where you can use our 80-inch screen TV to put a PowerPoint on, or for businesses, it's just sort of a getaway and an experience sharing kind of thing. We've got a tour plus lunch scheduled for about 50 people next month, and we're working on another possible one for the month after that. And so, you know, that's the kind of thing where it's a different thing than spending 3 hours on a walking tour with you know, just a maximum of like 12 people. And we do it differently, but it's still a lot of fun, and we have the ability, after doing all these other things, we know, you know, we have great vendors, and we know where to get whatever is needed.
We've had our first wedding here, and I actually performed the ceremony across the street at this wonderful lavender bee honey farm with all the freshly cut lavender smelling great and a beautiful view. And then we had the wedding dinner back here at Ranch Obi-Wan. That was a lot of fun. So, you know, we're open for events of just about any size.
Well, you really do keep busy.
And yeah.
Recently, you were on Brian Stillman's documentary, Plastic Galaxy, The Story of Star Wars Toys, about the Kenner Star Wars line. And we had him on the show a few episodes ago, and we asked him some questions he wasn't really sure of, so we figured we'd go right to the source, to you.
Okay.
Now, why did the first line of 12 Star Wars action figures not come with any of the popular cantina creatures?
Well, that's going to be speculation on my part, but speculation based on some knowledge. And Kenner was very, very limited in the beginning in the kind of resources that they were given by Lucasfilm. And the cantina scene in particular, no one really expected it to be as popular as it was. It was just sort of, oh, you know, there's this interlude. George had this idea, number one. Number two, George was not happy with the footage that he got in the UK. So it was much later, much closer to the actual opening of the film, that he redid much of the cantina in Los Angeles at a soundstage in L.A. And so that's where a number of the masks were added and a number of the characters were added. And so it was too late to really get into that first line of figures. They were lucky, as we know, as collectors. The first action figures didn't come out for about 9 months after the movie opened.
Mm-hmm.
But that is most likely the answer, is those two factors.
Right. Yeah, you know what? I never really did the math on that. They shot that in March. When the movie came out 2 months later.
Wow.
And now, finally, as being a huge Star Wars fan that you are, and like all of us, we can't go a day without using a Star Wars quote. What Star Wars quote do you use regularly?
I think my favorite Star Wars quote of all time is from our little green friend. And it's... you know, do or do not, there is no try. And that's been one of my philosophies of life ever since I first heard it. It made a lot of sense to me.
Oh.
That's probably one of my, or is my favorite Star Wars quote. But the one I think I go to regularly is, it gets everywhere when talking about sand. It's just something that always comes up when someone says something that annoys them. I always have to say, and it gets everywhere.
Yeah.
Good deal. Well, Steve, thank you very much for your time. We really, really appreciate it, and thank you once again for everything that you're doing for the fan community. You are like the figurehead of Star Wars fandom.
Well, thank you, Richard. Thank you, Sarah. I had a lot of fun, so it was great. Thank you very much.
That was a lot of fun, and I've been waiting so long to talk to Steven about everything that's going on, because there's not a day goes by that he doesn't have a new post about something that Rancho Obi-Wan has going. Like he said earlier, the Rancho Obi-Wan Gala is happening on September 20th, 2014. Now, if you want to go, all are welcome. However, you're welcome if you have a membership to Rancho Obi-Wan.
Right.
Or if you're going in a group, at least one of you has got to be a member. Now, to be a member costs you $40.
Yeah, that's the least expensive membership level.
Yeah, and I can't tell you how much it's worth, just the $40 alone, because you get a big membership kit as well as being a member of Rancho Obi-Wan.
That's true, and you get great stuff like a 3.5-inch Obi-Wan patch, and then a membership card signed by Steve, and a first in a series 4x6 card featuring concept art by John Molo.
I would buy anything by John Molo. He's such a great, fantastic costume designer. And you have access to the Rancho Obi-Wan store. Now, when we were just at Rancho Obi-Wan last time, I think I walked away with like $100 worth of stuff. Yeah. There's just so much stuff to get there.
Well, that was also before the stuff was offered online. And so there was like this little shop with like a tiny little shop with a bunch of stuff in it. And you're like, oh, I want one of that and one of that and one of that.
And you can get tour tickets. If you have the $40 membership, you can get tour tickets for $60 each.
Oh, it's
do
worth
it.
It's worth it.
So now, if you want to get in touch with Steve, you can email him at info@ranchoobiwan.org.
And there's no hyphen in the Obi-Wan.
No, no.
And to connect with Steve on Twitter, you can connect with him at @ranchoobiwan.
And once again, no hyphen between the Obi and the Wan.
Right.
Or you can go to Facebook at facebook.com/ranchoobiwan. And if you hurry, you could be his 11,000th like.
Wow.
He's at that 11,000 cusp. Who will bring him over the edge?
Steve was reluctant to start his own personal Facebook page, but was forced into it when someone in South America started one as him.
Yeah, they didn't start one on behalf of Steve Sansweet.
No.
They started one as if they were Steven Sansweet.
They were impersonating him.
In South America, of all places.
Yeah, that's so random. So last Monday, Billy Dee Williams debuted with Emma Slater on Dancing with the Stars.
I'm Billy Dee Williams. I'm best known for a character I played in Star Wars called Lando Calrissian.
Now, if you watched Dancing with the Stars like we had suggested last week, and we hope you did and voted, you saw his Star Wars dance.
Mm-hmm.
And he danced with R2-D2 and two stormtroopers.
And, of course, Emma Slater dressed in a Slave Leia-like outfit.
Now, she pulled a Jennifer Aniston on this one, where she had the Return of the Jedi gold bikini, but yet with the Star Wars New Hope buns, just like Jennifer Aniston did in the Friends episode.
Yes. It's like, you're almost there, but she has a braid.
Yeah.
Which, the braid is a lot sexier, I'm just saying.
Now, Billy Dee sums it all up in his intro package before his dance. He says,
I'm doing pretty good for a 77-year-old.
Now, grasp that. He's 77.
77.
And goes on,
I have arthritis in my back, and I had two hip operations, so I'm working against all of that.
Billy's commitment and determination is fantastic, and I feel like that's because he's got something to prove to everybody. Ready to try it again?
Yeah.
Okay, Princess Leia's coming for you.
I want to meet the challenge. I want to see if I can do it. Since I was a kid, I used to say that you'll have to catch me dead before I give up.
Whoever doesn't believe in Lando Calrissian and thinks that he's still a betrayer, you're going to eat this cha-cha.
Mm-hmm. He was decked out in his iconic Lando Calrissian gear.
Yeah, and he started out with the cape.
Yeah, oh yeah, gotta have the cape.
Yeah.
In that blue shirt with the black stripe. Mm-hmm. And they danced to the John Williams. Oh, it was a John Williams-esque type Star Wars tune.
Wasn't it the
Miko?
Yeah.
No, it wasn't the Miko, because they had their own orchestra there.
Okay.
So they played it live there. Now, following their dance, one of the judges, Bruno Tonioli, who is a big Star Wars fan, he let the Star Wars theme jokes and puns rip.
What'd he say?
He said,
I can never forgive you for freezing Han Solo. Oh. I still haven't recovered from it. I still haven't. Listen, what happened is I think you got the wrong character. You played it very dainty, very careful, very C-3PO. You know what I mean? I want Darth Vader. Bigger, more powerful.
This is not the judge you were looking for, yes.
Oh.
He played it dainty. But still, he'll sometimes give these Star Wars references when judging dancers. Like with Chaz Bono said that Chaz danced like an Ewok.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I know you were like so floored by that,
wow,
Mark.
It's a random thing to say.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, the judges only gave Billy Dee 5s out of a possible 10.
Yeah, so he got a total of 15 out of 30 points. But
let's not forget, he's 77 years old.
Mm-hmm.
He's had two hip replacements, and he's been walking with a cane. And he's 77 years old.
That's right.
You got to give a little bit of leeway, too.
That's
true. He's competing against 20-year-old Olympians.
Yeah, and 17-year-old singers. And
he got a rousing applause.
Can we talk about how much the audience loved you? I'm sorry, are you listening to that?
Everyone loves him.
Mm-hmm.
And even Len Goodman, the stodgy old judge, gave him some words of wisdom.
You were on time. You didn't forget your routine. It was entertaining. You just need to come out with a little bit more. But listen, you've got two hip replacements. You're 77. You did a good job. Well done.
I'm so glad he's on there. And I know I saw a lot in social media about how people were going to watch it, even though they had never watched Dancing with the Stars before. So Dancing with the Stars definitely brought in a different audience by having Billy Dee Williams on.
Now, they stay on the show because of not only the judges' scores, but people's votes.
It's 50-50, I believe.
Right, but okay, but still, he needs your votes.
Yes.
He needs your votes.
Yeah, just Facebook.com is the easiest way.
We've got to get him at least to week four.
Yeah, come on, guys.
Now, we have an old friend of Lando's on the phone right now. All the way from Cloud City, it's Lobot. Lobot, hey, it's Richard.
And this is Sarah.
Hey, so what did you think of your old boss's cha-cha dance on Dancing with the Stars? Hello?
Hello?
Lobot? I can't tell if he's there or not. Lobot? He's very quiet. I'm sure he was very impressed by Lando's dance, and he'll call in later on when he's got something to say. And we will see Billy Dee's fate on Monday, March 24th, to see if he's going to go on to the next week.
We want to take a moment to thank everyone for listening to Skywalking Through Neverland, the ultimate expression of fandom. We are once again on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, and also online on our website, skywalkingthroughneverland.com. And we'd like to give a few shout-outs this week.
Shout-outs, shout-outs.
Now, last week, we talked to our guest, Gary Oransky, about the Star Wars parody Happy video, parodying Pharrell Williams' Happy video that was shot in Tunisia. And I was looking around on Twitter, asking people, you know, who's behind this? We really wanted to know. And at Old Zora on Twitter tweeted us back and tweeted us a video blog from the shoot by the C-3PO Builders Club of Iway and Simon. And Simon is at SW3PO on Twitter. So this 8-minute YouTube video is a great little video blog if you want to learn more about the shoot, and including on how they put the costumes together and what it took them to get from place to place. It's really interesting.
Yeah, thank you, Sarah Cole. Because I knew nothing about this video. I couldn't find any behind the scenes or anything. And then this 8-minute video showed us everything.
Yeah. We were also busy on Twitter this week making new friends. And one of the friends we made was at Pixie Dust Podcast on Twitter. And they checked out our website and left a voicemail message for you to hear.
Hi guys, this is Melissa from the Pixie Dust Podcast. We just wanted to say thank you so much for the follow on Twitter. And this feature on your website was so cool that I just had to leave you a message. Our podcast is coming out real soon, so please tune in and listen. Thank you so much. Have a magical day.
They're still working on their website and podcast. They're just starting up, but it looks like another fun acquaintance that we made in that crazy realm we call the internet. So if you want to also meet up with us there, hit us up on @SkywalkingPod to join in the conversation.
So if you haven't liked us on Facebook yet, go on over and like us. And every day we'll post a new question of the day, which has been very fun because people are really, really creative and innovative with their answers. And we also do This Day in Star Wars History.
So that's right.
There's lots to join in on and lots to learn.
Yeah, in fact, this past week we did a This Day in Star Wars History post that for some reason went a little viral, in our world anyway. It was shared 40 times, but it was a picture of the U.S. Postal Service Star Wars transformed mailboxes that they were transformed into R2-D2s. And it was shared 40 times across Facebook, mostly to celebrate how cute they are. But some people, I looked a little later in the day, and some people had shared it as a rant, exclaiming, "Please tell me taxpayer dollars did not pay for these. I didn't get to vote on this." Ugh. That was a little random.
Seriously?
Yeah. But most of these were shared in like Star Wars groups and things. So we appreciate that that these mailboxes were celebrated. So join us once again on Facebook, and you too can participate in these fun day in Star Wars history posts and our questions of the day.
What was one of our most popular ones last week?
The questions of the day?
Yeah.
Actually, one of them was, if Walt Disney were to sign up for Twitter, what would be his first tweet?
We've got tons and tons of answers for that. Just
yes.
Really, really funny stuff.
And in fact, a lot of answers were, some of them were the same. Like you posted it in Disney groups and they all said, it all started with a mouse. But I think some Star Wars fans got a little creative. In fact, Adam Medina, one of our fans, said, you pay how much for an annual pass? That would be Walt Disney's first tweet. Oh, that was cute.
That's funny.
Yeah. Now, I want to give a shout out to Donald Wicks, who one night just asked several of his friends to like our page on Facebook, and it was really effective. So thank you, Donald. We got a lot of likes that night. And also, we'd like to welcome Donald to our Facebook admin team. So he'll be helping us post from time to time. And if you haven't yet liked Skywalking Through Neverland, you're missing out on the conversation. So get over there.
Yeah, if you're a listener and you haven't liked us, don't worry, we're not mad. We're furious. So get over there now.
Like Palpatine furious.
Yeah.
Now, Donald Wicks also had another great idea, which he brought up to us, a once-a-month Skywalking Through Neverland trivia challenge that listeners would be able to participate in via a Google Hangout or a Skype call. So that's in the planning phase, and we'll be rolling it out next month. Now, if you guys have any ideas about that or are interested in that, please let us know on Facebook, facebook.com/skywalkingthroughneverland. Now, one other thing we want to ask our fans, if you head on over to iTunes or Stitcher Radio and give us a review, we will, in return, of course, give you a shout-out on next week's podcast. So you can find links to both iTunes and Stitcher on our website, skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
And tonight, we are talking to Skywalking Through Neverland's movie go-to guy, Mark Ogushowitz. I thought I was a big Muppet fan, but Mark may have me beat on this one. Now, last Friday, March 21st, the most anticipated movie of the spring season, according to me, Muppets Most Wanted, was released. And we're going to give everyone a week to see it before we do a recap next week. But as for today, we're going to get a little background on Jim Henson's phenomenal creation. Hey, hey, Mark.
Hey, how's it going?
It is going great because we're talking about the Muppets.
The Muppets.
Aside from Star Wars, Muppets is just right up there for me. One of my greatest Muppet memories is going back to November 14th, 2002. And you were there with me. Do you recall this?
Yep, it was a special day for two reasons. That was the day that Kermit the Frog got his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
Oh, well, you know, I was talking about your birthday.
That was the second thing. That's Kermit got his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame on my birthday.
Wow.
Wow. That's...
So my birthday and Kermit the Frog Day, which they, you know, they always call it the day of the person getting the star, are now the same day.
That's like a Star Wars movie opening up on my birthday. I was living right around the corner from Hollywood Boulevard, and you called me to come right over to see Kermit the Frog getting a star.
I remember I don't remember how I found out about it, but I got all excited because on my birthday. I don't generally go to these kinds of things, but come on, Kermit the Frog getting his star, and it's on my birthday. So I remember I called you, and you said you could be there real fast. And I remember I was about a half hour late, which was because I wasn't used to being up in that area. Mm. But it was a cool day. It was a lot of fun. We got to meet Sweetums. We got our pictures taken with Sweetums.
Yeah, that was great because that was a time when not everyone had a camera at their disposal.
On their phones?
On their phones. So I think we were the only ones to get a picture with Sweetums. Because he was just milling about, and no one was saying anything to him. And we called him over, and we got some pictures.
Yeah, I remember. Matter of fact, I lost that picture for a long, long time, and I thought it was gone for good. But about 6 months ago, I got an office for the first time, and as I was just going through paperwork, there it was. I was so excited.
Yay!
Yeah, and also that was the day that I had an actual conversation with Kermit the Frog.
Whoa.
Wait a minute, I don't remember that. I'm jealous.
The ceremony had just ended. They were taking apart the stage.
Okay.
So here he was just sitting there. And who does the Kermit voice these days? Steve Whitmore?
Steve Whitmore.
So it must have been him doing the Kermit voice because it sounded just like him.
Mm-hmm.
And he was just sitting there waiting for someone to release him. So I said, "Hey, Kermit." And he looks over at me. We had this little conversation.
Oh, so did you guys actually see the ceremony?
Yes.
Itself.
Yes.
So what? How did they put Kermit's feet in the cement?
It was a star. It wasn't the footprints in front of the Grauman Theater.
I guess I thought they'd go hand in hand.
No, it's two separate ceremonies where he's got his star, which is right in front of the Kodak Theater.
Okay. But did they present him with like his little mini star?
Oh, yeah.
He's behind a podium, so you don't see the person, you know, right, operating him. Although I'll tell you this. This is really interesting. Is they had a thing. It was called Muppet Palooza 1 year. It was supposed to be a traditional thing, but it only lasted 1 year. And
where?
It was in Santa Monica. And I remember it was an interesting day because I wasn't able to go Saturday and Sunday, which was a bummer because on Saturday, that's when all the performers were like signing autographs and everything. And I could only go on Sunday. But we went there and it was mostly adults. It was like 99% adults. And it was like really cool. And they had the Muppet performers up on stage with the puppets on their hands performing. And people would go up and ask them questions and stuff.
Wow.
And you saw the Muppet performer, the performers sitting there, you know, operating the puppets.
Oh.
But not for an instant did you ever realize that's what was going on. You were just talking to those puppets as if you didn't even realize those other guys were there. People were asking questions straight to the puppets, and after about a minute it was almost like they were invisible because the puppets take on such a life of their own. And I'm sorry, these performers have got to be the greatest improv geniuses on the planet. The way they were coming up with things, you know, left and right off the top of their heads. And because of the way that Kermit and Gonzo and Fozzie, you know, act and the dimension that they give them, you totally forget there's somebody sitting right next to them. You just totally buy that Kermit is sitting right in front of you. And it's part of the genius of who the Muppets are.
Yeah, I had seen something similar with all the Muppets and all the Muppeteers, but only it was at a sadder occasion at Jim Henson's funeral. In 1990, in New York City, and I was living in Boston, so a friend and I drove over to New York, which is only 5 hours away, and they wanted everyone to wear only bright clothing because Jim Henson would have wanted it that way, to wear. So everyone was always, always happy.
Jim Henson wanted his life to be celebrated.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so come in and celebrate life. Come in. It's really kind of interesting because that's the kind of person he was. He never really shied away from anything. After he died, it just wasn't forgotten by the kids either. I was just watching this today. I was looking something up and it popped up. But they had done a kind of tribute to him where the Muppets actually, you know, they're behind the scenes on the Muppet Show stage, you know, in the backstage area. And they're all talking about how they're going to do this tribute. And they got some, they make it sound like there's some big gala going to happen. And they start reading actual letters from actual kids about how much they miss him and how much he meant to them before they then break into a little tiny, very emotional song. Because he was not about, I don't know, it was more like, you know, hey, don't back away from it. Let's celebrate the fact our life. He did the same thing with Mr. Hooper on Sesame Street.
Right.
Where they kind of wanted to make it look like Mr. Hooper had just gone away and moved away. And Jim Henson was like, no, this is a perfect opportunity to teach kids about death. You know, he always saw like it was a lesson. It was something we celebrate life. We don't get, you know, it's not something to be depressed about. We should be looking back and saying, you know, this was a great guy. This was, you know, we really appreciated having this person in our life.
Now, Richard, do you remember at that memorial, was anyone wearing black?
I don't remember. I don't remember what I was wearing.
Okay.
But I remember Brian Henson wearing bright yellow.
Yeah.
First of all, I was very, very surprised that they let fans attend. Because it was a huge church. Place was stuffed to the gills.
Wow.
At first, you forgot it was even a funeral because it was like a big party. And then Frank Oz gets up and he's talking about the Saturday Night Live days. And he just starts to cry.
Aww.
And the whole place just silenced. Then you hear one big wave of weeps. It was extremely sad. As soon as you start to break apart, Big Bird comes out. Oh, and it was so, so heart-wrenching.
Jim Henson was, he was one of these guys. I mean, I don't think people understand how important he was to not just kids, but to the world. I mean, Sesame Street is seen in so many countries, and especially now at a time when schools, you know, are kind of questionable, Sesame Street was a real entertaining way that taught so many children.
Absolutely.
And not only like your ABCs, but life lessons and, you know, and stuff like that. I mean, you can look at a lot of the entertainers for children, like Walt Disney, who was also very important to kids. But I think Jim Henson might have been a little bit more so because of what Sesame Street did.
Right. I see your point
there. It really did teach our kids, you know, everything they should be learning in school.
Well, I remember in kindergarten, I would come down to the kitchen to have breakfast. Mom would sit me on the stool. I'd have my cereal, and I would watch Mr. Rogers and Sesame Street, and then I'd be off to kindergarten.
Now, did you grow up on the Muppets too, Mark?
You know, I grew up on the Muppets. Everybody grew up on the Muppets. But I think I have more of an appreciation of them now as an adult, because when you grow up with them as a kid, you kind of just see them as a form of entertainment and their puppets kind of running around. But now as an adult, you can kind of look back and see why they were as good at what they did as they were. And they weren't just Barney and they weren't just some of these other things. They really spoke to us as kids because they were real. I still have a hard time thinking that I would walk into the Jim Henson Production Company, or I guess it would be Disney now, and see them up on posts. I think that would be really hard for me.
Mm. Yeah, yeah. Well, they need to be alive when you see them.
Yeah, well, and it's just because they were so alive. It wasn't kids watching a puppet show. It was kids watching real characters, a real frog, a real pig, who had real relationships and who had real quirks and had real craziness to them. It's just really weird to think that, you know, you would walk in and you wouldn't see them running around, you know, actually communicating with people. And it was just part of the Jim Henson genius. You know, my understanding is when they make Muppet movies that you're only supposed to talk to the puppets. You're not supposed to talk to the performers. And I think that that is part of this whole entire reason why when you go to the movies, you see you watch actors and they're flat characters with no characterization. And then you go watch the Muppets and it's like, oh my God, they're so real.
Now, you had mentioned earlier about the documentary Being Elmo, and you know Kevin Clash personally.
Yeah, I was lucky enough to work with him recently.
Has he ever told you stories about the time? Because in the documentary, they'll show him going to schools with Elmo, and you can clearly see him right there holding the Muppet, but kids never look at him. They just look at Elmo.
But if you watch that documentary, he's very clear on why these puppets work. He talks about – I was listening to him interviewed they do these interviews at the Apple Store every once in a while that they post in a podcast. And he was talking to the person interviewing him, and the interviewer, I guess, had noticed that Elmo was – interacting with all the kids while he was talking to the interviewer. And he had said that that was really important, that the puppet always be looking around, the puppet always be interacting, that puppet should never, ever just be sitting there looking in one spot. Because that ruins the illusion, because when you are, when a person is kind of like sitting there in one spot, you're generally, you know, your eyes are glancing around, you're, you know, you're moving, you know, you're never perfectly still.
Yeah, when I do my puppet shows for schools and libraries, I'll talk to the librarians or the teachers, or I'll have the puppet actually answer the question. And then they'll turn and they'll look at the puppet and talk to them. And they always finish it up by, why am I talking to a puppet?
Well, and that's the interesting thing. That's what's really great. When I was at Muppapalooza, that happened. But if you'll notice, I mean, there are very few really great puppeteers. You had Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy. You had the guy on the show Soap. I don't know if you remember watching Soap, where he had the puppet.
Yeah.
And there was always the joke that everybody would talk to the puppet and not to him. And then you have the Muppets. Jim Henson and all of his puppeteers, and Frank Oz and Bill Beretta and all them, they've got it down to such an art form that you never question that you're ever talking to anything but Kermit the Frog, anything but Fozzie Bear, anything but, you know, Miss Piggy, because they're so lifelike and they're so real. You know, you can watch them and they're almost, you can almost see their lip sync because of the way they, I think they talk on every consonant or something like that. They
open yeah. Up.
And they've got it down to such an art form. And it's actually pretty remarkable, because then you go watch other shows and it's kind of like, I don't understand why these people don't get it. You know,
now I'm going to throw one more puppeteer into the mix here. Paul Fusco. Who puppeteered Alf.
Yeah, Alf was great too, because Alf had such personality.
Oh, he had tremendous. Whenever I was doing a movie and I was puppeteering, I would always watch endless hours of Alf, because I would just get so much from watching it with the sound off, and I knew exactly what Alf was doing just by the way Paul Fusco puppeteered that puppet.
Well, Alf was interesting too, because like the show Alf, I always found kind of blah, because I never thought that the people around him were very interesting where he was. But if you ever saw Alf, he used to do Super Bowl stuff, and he also used to be on Hollywood Squares. I mean, this guy, I mean, it was Alf. He wasn't a puppet. He was an alien. I bought every second of it because of his personality. And that is like key. One of the things that the Muppets did that I don't see even puppeteers after the fact doing. If you watch Kermit the Frog and the way his face scrunches up, mm-hmm. give reactions, or Gonzo's got these eyelids that kind of back up a little bit, or the animal can give this look that is so real. And it's like, why aren't other puppeteers kind of why aren't they catching up? Why aren't they doing this? You know? And then when they create the puppets, to an extent, they make them look as real as they can for the audience they have. I was watching Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles the other day, and my God, Splinter, who was created by the Jim Henson Production Company, they dirty him up so much because he's chained to a wall through most of the movie that they didn't say, hey, we're going to just make this clean puppet. We're going to make it, we're going to dirty him up, we're going to, you know, mess up his hair. The creations for the Dark Crystal and just the detail on the wrinkles and everything. Then you go and watch something like Barney, and it's like, I don't get it.
Have you ever seen The Great Space Coaster? Come on.
Oh my God, a long time ago.
Yeah, I was just watching an old clip that had Mark Hamill on it, and it was so hilarious because the puppeteer would often mess up his lines and then just keep on going. He'll stop and start again, and you can see Mark Hamill trying to laugh.
Aww.
When you deal with a lot of these kids performers, there's this mentality of, oh, they're just kids. It's not going to matter to kids, which is why, you know, Pixar stands out and a lot of Disney stands out, mm-hmm. Especially when Walt Disney was in charge, and the Muppets stand out. Is their attitude is not, we're just dealing with kids. Oh, if we make a mistake, don't worry about it. It's just a kid. They got their art form down to a perfection because they realize kids are smart. Kids are intelligent. They're not just kids, you know? And so when I hear stories about stuff like that, where they just don't even care enough to, hey, cut, let's do it again, edit it together, it kind of bothers me a little bit.
Yeah, but you had to have seen it, because it was very, it took you out of the moment in a good way, going, wow, that really felt real, like a real conversation. Like so when you're watching a Pixar movie and you see bloopers, it's like, well, that couldn't have happened, but it did happen, and it just makes it feel so much more real.
Are you laughing at it because of it, this kind of stupidity of somebody? I mean, I haven't seen it, so...
No, I'm not. I'm laughing because it was such a real moment. That's
so you're saying it felt more natural.
Yes, right. Very much so. The puppeteer never missed a beat. Even when he was stumbling, he would still manipulate the puppet to go through the stumbling.
Huh.
So the mouth never stopped moving while he tried to... While he got his brain back on track. So the puppet was as fumbled as the puppeteer.
So are you sure it was a fumble and it wasn't all done on purpose? Because, you watch the Muppet bloopers all the time.
No, this was not done on purpose. You can tell it was not done. This was a very, very low-budget show. It's like Econo Muppets. So I grew up watching the Muppet Show, and I'm sure, Mark, you did too. Now, Sarah, after Sesame Street, did you watch the Muppet Show too?
No, I never really watched that, but I did watch Muppet Babies. And I loved that show. It was so cute.
Now, let me ask you this.
Uh-huh.
Did you know that the Muppet Babies were not always cartoons?
What?
No.
Richard, you didn't know that? The Muppet Babies got started in Muppets Take Manhattan.
Oh, that's right.
They had that flashback where Miss Piggy and Kermit are talking. I think they're in a carriage ride or something. And she's like, wouldn't it have been wonderful if we had known each other as babies?
Wow. Right.
And then they flash back to the Muppet Babies singing a song. And Ralph all beaten, a little baby Ralph beaten on his piano. And
oh, well, the thing I remember about the Muppet Babies, which is interesting, is that I saw the Muppet Babies Star Wars episode before I ever saw Star Wars. And I was like, whoa, what is this? This is pretty cool. And then when I actually saw Star Wars for the first time, I was like, wait a minute. And I went back and watched that episode of the Muppet Babies, and then everything like clicked. But I remembered that.
And for those out there who've never seen Muppet Babies Star Wars Edition, we're going to play that for our vintage video clip this week, because I happen to have it.
Of course you do.
Of course you do.
So, Mark, you said that you did not really have an appreciation for the Muppets until you were an adult. How did that happen?
Well, like I said, I grew up on the Muppets and Sesame Street, but as a kid, it was just a form of entertainment. It was just, a lot of fun. I didn't really understand what the Muppets were. And then I became a big movie buff, and I actually went to film school. And I came back, and I'd work in the movie theaters in order to get into movies for free. And the Muppets Christmas Carol came out. And I saw everything that came out. Got in free, go see everything. So I remembered the Muppets as a kid, and I go walking into a Muppet Christmas Carol thinking I'm just going to go see some kids' movie. And I was just blown away by it. Everything about it. It opens up with this long tracking shot over the rooftops, and then you go in and there's this huge production design that you don't even see in movies with, regular people in them. It opened with this great musical number. Michael Caine gives this, I thought it was an Oscar-worthy performance, not only because he's really good in it, but he's acting opposite a bunch of puppets. It's where I was really introduced to Rizzo the Rat, who became one of my favorites. But I just was drawn in by the fact that how intelligent the humor was and how they weren't talking down to the kids and how in a lot of ways it was more for adults in a lot of ways. And just the smarts behind the jokes that were happening and the humor that was happening and the musical numbers, how great they were, that when that movie was over, I was kind of like, this isn't what I remember. And so I had to now go and check out more Muppet stuff. When I get into somebody and I see somebody I like, I all of a sudden have to go check out the rest of their stuff. And as I started watching the Muppet movie, and you got Dom DeLuise coming in, and Kermit the Frog is like, snapping at flies, eating flies. And Dom DeLuise says, I got to catch a plane. And Kermit just looks at him and says, with that tongue?
Hey, say that again, but do it in the Kermit voice.
I don't have a Kermit voice. You don't want to hear a Kermit voice from me. I respect him too much for that. That joke alone was just like so smart. And then later on in the movie, it's that whole, you know, take a right in the fork in the road, and then they go past and there's a fork stuck in the road. Uh-huh. I just was like, oh my God, what is this that I'm watching? And I just started kind of thinking back to how smart Monty Python is. And that's what this was. It was just like this really smart writing. And I just started – you watch The Great Muppet Caper, and the first like hour of that film is so smart and intelligent that you're just like, what? This is a lot more than I expected from a bunch of puppets. And I started to research it. And as a screenwriter, somebody who's written screenplays and stuff, and you're always hearing about characterization, I just started realizing why they were working. You know, Kermit had his quirks and he had his personalities, and Miss Piggy was very different, and she wasn't just some, you know, flat character. She had personality, and her karate and her love mm-hmm. for Kermit and Kermit's kind of rejection on her. And then you just start watching it, and Gonzo's completely different, and Waldorf and Statler completely different, and Fozzie, and it's like, oh my God, this is like a real comedy troupe of real characters. Mm-hmm. And then you start watching The Muppet Show and just the art behind it. I just fell in love. It's like Jim Henson all of a sudden became one of my all-time favorite entertainers. And he still, to this day, is, in my opinion, one of the greatest entertainers of all time. And I'm not just talking about for kids. I'm just talking about in general. He knew how to make something smart. He knew how to make something intelligent. He knew that kids were watching it, but adults were coming in too, so we better have some jokes for the adults. He knew that there had to be character arcs. He knew that the characters had to have relationships. And there's so much of that missing in movies, and that it was just so refreshing to see this comedy troupe. And I kind of think of the Muppets as a comedy troupe the way you think of Monty Python as a comedy troupe. There was just so much more than what I remember as a kid when I was just watching a puppet running around. And I think that's why they've lasted as long as they have. And I think that's why they're so endearing. When Kermit the Frog appears on a talk show, people are just so excited to see him. Kermit the Frog actually hosted Johnny Carson once. Hmm. And he can pull it off because it's not just some flat puppet walking around. It's just real. People ask me, you know, about screenwriting and stuff like that. I always say you should study the Muppets because you want to know about building character and smarts. That's how you do it.
Right.
Then for the longest time, the Muppets just went away. We didn't see anything of them. Even after Disney had bought them, they had a Disney attraction over at Disneyland and Disney World, but you didn't really hear much of the Muppets. And working with kids, I've made references to the Muppets, and they look at me like I'm asking them to solve a word problem. Then, in 2011, the new Muppet movie came out. How do you compare that new era of Muppets to the old school era of Muppets?
You know something, I was so glad to see the Muppets come out, and I was really looking forward to it because I guess Jason Segel, who was the human star, was a big, big Muppet fan and actually pitched the Muppets to Disney, which is how it all got started. And through him being such a fan, he really, when they wrote that, they really brought us back to the old Muppets. The Muppets had kind of lost their way for a little while in the way that Disney at one time had lost its way with like Treasure Planet and stuff. Mm-hmm. And it took somebody who was a real fan to bring it back around. And I thought, with the exception of cutting Rizzo out of the movie, and I hope he's in the new one, I thought they were incredibly respectful. I mean, they brought back Muppets like Wayne and Wanda that we hadn't seen since The Muppet Show. Very, very respectful. The humor was back. The characterizations were back. There were a couple of things that I don't understand the Muppet Man thing, and one of these days I'm going to look it up. It's something that didn't work for me in the film. But overall, I think Jim Henson, looking down, would be very proud. Especially there's a moment in the film, my favorite moment in the movie, and probably one of my all-time favorite Muppet moments, And that's when Kermit the Frog is walking down the hallway singing with the pictures all coming to life.
Mm. Yeah, I was so happy that they tied this new film into the old era because they had to save the Muppet Theater. And I was so happy to see that.
Where they were really smart was they told it as if we were – as if the Muppets were real. Because remember, Muppets have kind of – they kind of got forgotten. You would see them every once in a while. And they have some really, really – their viral videos have been really great, like the Bohemian Rhapsody. But they had done – I read somewhere that they had done a survey and like 75% of kids didn't know who the Muppets were.
No, they don't. They had no idea.
And so what's this movie about? The movie's about the Muppets being forgotten. And having to be remembered and get themselves back out there. And they used Walter, this new Muppet, as the big fan because even though they've kind of started to get forgotten, there were still fans out there.
Right.
And so they took the Muppets from where they were and they said, we're just going to act as if this is the Muppets where they are and they need to be rediscovered. And the fact that the movie was as good as it was allowed the ending to work because the movie allowed them to be rediscovered the way they are rediscovered in the movie.
Now, do you think the Muppets Most Wanted is going to determine the future of the Muppets the way the Empire Strikes Back did with the Star Wars saga? Because if Empire didn't work, there'd be no Return of the Jedi.
No, I actually don't, because I think that the Muppets have now been rediscovered. When you go back to Empire Strikes Back, Star Wars was a new thing. And so Empire was a branch of that new thing that had to continue. The Muppets are a rediscovery, and I think that they have been rediscovered. And the Muppets Most Wanted, if it bombs, I think it's going to hurt. Mm-hmm. But if it's good, I think that we'll see more Muppets, because the Muppets aren't something that only live in the movie world.
Right, okay.
They're all over the internet now, and they do these really great viral videos, and you'll see them on talk shows. I just discovered something the other day where they had hosted some big gala in Canada for some comedy club, like a big comedy club up there was celebrating 30 years, and they had the Muppets come in and host. They open it with this really great opening number where they're kind of putting down Canada because, like, who knows what Canada is? And they're right in front of a Canadian audience. It's really funny because it was very lighthearted and smart. So I don't think if the Muppets Most Wanted isn't great, I don't think it'll kill the Muppets, but it may hurt them a little bit. But we're trying to look on the bright side, thinking that it's smart, because another thing that the Muppets have done since the last movie is you'll notice that they're using real stars as cameos. For a while, they were putting like Queen Latifah in their film, and they were putting people who were stars, but they were television stars, and that's why it didn't get any attention. But if you go back to when Jim Henson did it, he was getting Steve Martin and Dom DeLuise and Mel Brooks and Charles Grodin and Orson Welles and Muppet Christmas Carol had Michael Caine. They took it serious enough to go get the real serious people. And so what do they get from Muppets Most Wanted? Not only Ricky Gervais, but even better than that is Tina Fey.
Which arguably she's a TV star, but she's definitely crossed over.
She's crossed over to movies, but she's like Steve Martin to me was always the best person to cameo with the Muppets because his humor was so intelligent, but he could get so zany and ridiculous.
Right.
Tina Fey is the same way. She's like a female Steve Martin. She's our modern day Steve Martin. And she's so intelligent and so smart that the movies that she's written have been very smart. And so getting her in there with the Muppets, I thought was a very smart move and gets me really kind of looking forward to this whole thing. And I can't imagine it's the same director, one of the same writers. I can't imagine that it's going to be anything but great. Now, I've read some of the reviews, and they've confused me a little bit, but...
don't read the reviews before you've seen it.
A lot of the reviewers don't know the Muppets.
But a lot of the reviews are basically, they're giving it, like, 3 out of 5 stars, but they're saying it's hilarious, and it's like, well, why is it getting this little? They're saying that it's hitting every mark. But supposedly, I guess they want a lot of people are wanting the Muppets again, in the sense the movie The Muppets again. And my understanding is this one's a little bit more humor, doesn't have all the as much heart. It's concentrating more on the humor, which is fine by me and most Muppet fans, because the Muppets are like, and I keep bringing this up because it's the best example. The Muppets are like Monty Python. They're all about the humor and the funny. But because they're also very real and do have some of that heart, that's what makes it even funnier and more enjoyable.
The one thing that I'm very happy to see once again is that Fozzie Bear is back. Because for a long time, I don't know who was puppeteering him or who was doing the voice, but it just wasn't Fozzie Bear. And I've always related to Fozzie Bear. He was always my Muppet.
I think it's the same. The same can be said for all of them, with the exception of Miss Piggy. I don't think Miss Piggy ever went away. I think she's always had her attitude. And I also think that when Steve Whitmire took over for Kermit, he's always kind of kept that consistent. But I always thought like Waldorf and Statler had gotten flat. Yeah. And a lot of the other characters had kind of lost a little bit of their edge. But with the new movie, The Muppets, I feel like they got all that back. You know, Ralph the dog, I thought, was very much back. He's one of my favorites.
Now, Mark, which Muppet do you think you're most like and why?
Well, that's a reporter question.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. I do know this, that people have, and you can maybe make a comment on this. People have told me that me and my wife are like Kermit and Miss Piggy.
Which one's which?
Well, I'm the more serious, and I get very, because I'm such a perfectionist, and I get very serious in what I do, and I'm very much, you know, that kind of person. We got to do, you know, this, and when I get into my projects, I want everything to be right. Whereas my wife, on the other hand, is kind of, you know, very bitchy and very I want it my way, and very much, you know, like that. Although I'm probably got the body of Miss Piggy with us, because I'm more plus size than she is. But yeah, a lot of people have compared us to them, and it's nothing that's intentional. It just, when you really kind of look at it, it kind of fits.
Now, Sarah, what Muppet do you think you're the most like?
Well, it's hard to say because I'm a girl. There are not many girl Muppets besides Miss Piggy.
Well, if you pick the boys or girl Muppets. Now, Mark, you've known Sarah for quite some time. Think about which one you think she is like. I already have an idea, but you think, but let's give her a chance to
weigh
in.
I don't know them as well. I've always liked Kermit. Something tells me I'm not Kermit.
Mark, what do you think?
I don't know. I'm trying to think. I wouldn't say Kermit because
Beaker?
You kind of got this side of you. I can't see Kermit I don't see Kermit dressing up to go to comic conventions and
no.
stuff.
Okay.
A little bit more serious minded than that. I don't know. I'm trying to think of a female Muppet because there are a little bit more than you would think. But I don't know if
I'm definitely not that rocker
chick. Like? I can't really.
She's not Janice.
No.
Okay.
No, I wouldn't put her like Janice.
I think Sarah is most like Robin.
Who dat?
Robin the Frog. Robin is Kermit's nephew.
You think?
Yeah. Robin is very wide-eyed and innocent. Always on the chipper side. Always looking for the best in people.
Aw. He's so cute.
I think that's Sarah.
You know, and I can see it a little bit. I can see a little bit, but I think she might have a little Gonzo in her. And I say that because, you know, you do all the Disney marathons and stuff like that. And Gonzo was always, you know, he was the guy who did the stunts. And so I think that I can see a lot of Robin in you, maybe with a touch of Gonzo in there.
Okay.
What
about you, Richard?
Fozzie Bear.
Really?
Fozzie Bear.
Because, well, I'd almost equate you with Kermit because you're so the alpha. You have your projects. You have to keep everyone in line.
Okay, maybe it does a little.
I guess Fozzie is the entertainer side.
Of
you.
He's the entertainer. He's always the one on stage. If there's a spotlight, he's right there.
Yeah. Okay, I can see that.
You know, I'll tell you this. I see Fozzie in you, but I'll tell you who Fozzie is. And he's somebody that you have on your show quite a bit, so your listeners are probably familiar with Dave Scale.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think that if you were to put I think that if you were to do like a kind of a mixture of Kermit the Frog and Fozzie Bear, we'd get Richard.
Yes.
All right.
But I think that David Scale is pure Fozzie Bear.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that. I can see that.
And then I would say that there's probably, in me and Richard, there's probably a little bit of Waldorf and Statler.
Yes.
Especially when we get together and start talking movies.
I think so. And I do admit I can be like selfish Miss Piggy sometimes.
Oh, you said
it. Yeah, but I think that's a woman thing, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so. And always looking nice. And yeah,
got to look around, make sure my wife's not around when I say that.
All right, Mark. Well, that should round up this segment on the Muppets. And we will look forward to talking to you next week to hear what you have to say about Muppets Most Wanted.
And I will not only be seeing Muppets Most Wanted, but I'm going to the El Capitan.
Ooh.
Which means there will be a show beforehand, and I will take pictures, if they allow me, of the props that they're supposed to have out in the lobby or downstairs.
You have your assignment.
And
off you go.
My assignment.
Hit it, R2.
Star Wars is everywhere.
My name, though, is C-3PO.
Kellogg's C-3POs.
Oh, no! Darth Vader!
Who?
I'm a teenager from outer space.
So it just so happens that my midichlorians were talking to me 30 years ago when I stumbled across and recorded a Muppet Babies episode where they recreated Star Wars.
I can't wait to see this again. I'm definitely watching this podcast.
All right, sit back and enjoy.
That's Chewbacca the Wookiee, Fozzie.
That's what I said, Kuchaka the Wookiee.
I want to be Scooter D2.
And I'll be Skeeter 3PO.
Yeah, and I'll be Obi-Rolf Kenobi.
Wait a minute. Aren't we forgetting someone important?
I'm Vader.
Okay, guys, we're ready to roll. Hey, Kermit, where are the stars? If this is Star Wars, we gotta have stars.
Coming right up, Gonzo. How's that?
That's great. Okay.
A far time ago, in a galaxy long, long away.
Hey, Kermit, I can see your hand.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, wow. George Lucas will let me direct his next movie, Star Weirdos? No way.
Now, that was only a few minutes of the Muppet Babies, so if you want to see the full clip,
go over to Skywalking Through Neverland on YouTube, and you'll be able to find it there. You will also be able to find it on our website if you click bonus content.
You know, I bet most of you are wondering what I was doing 34 years ago this week. Well, wonder no more. It's time to hear another passage from my journal and travel back to...
March 24, 1980. Yesterday, my father and I went to the book fair at the Sheraton Hotel in Boston. When you walk in, they have an Easter showcase. It's on a table. It's an Easter town made of chocolate. It took around 300 hours to do it all, and it took 980 pounds of chocolate to do it. Then we went up to the book fair. When we were there for half an hour, we saw a movie. It was little cartoon movies of Superman. When we were coming out, we went back to the book fair. I saw Empire Strikes Back poster. The guy wanted $15 for it, but he gave it to me for $5, and plus he threw in a Superman the movie book. After we went to McDonald's, and then we went home.
And now we get to see how fast time is really zipping by.
Mm-hmm.
It's countdown time.
Yay! To start us off for the countdown this week, we have Star Wars Weekends. Now, as of March 24th, there are only 55 days left.
That seems like nothing compared to everything else that we're going to go over.
I know, nothing at all. And it'll go away so fast. We'll have already put out, six more podcasts by then? It'll be very exciting.
Now, they've already announced their very first guest.
Yes. The Disney Parks blog finally announced the first guest, the first celebrity guest at Star Wars Weekends. And do you know who it was?
Go ahead and tell everyone. Go ahead and tell.
Well, okay. So, the Disney Parks blog starts off, his most famous film character has destroyed the Death Star, received the Medal of Bravery following the Battle of Yavin, and resisted a turn to the dark side. So what is he going to do next? He's going to Tosche Station to pick up some power converters. No, wait, wrong answer. He's going to Disney World.
Yep, the star of Corvette Summer himself, Mark Hamill.
Yay!
Wait a minute, he's going to be there in June, isn't he?
He is, June 6th through 8th, 2014.
Hopefully, after that, he'll get on a plane to London, where he's going to be shooting episode 7.
Yeah.
So why is he in Orlando if he should be in London shooting episode 7?
I don't know. Maybe he's shooting before or after that date?
We'll have to ask him.
Yes.
Oh, we're not going to be there that weekend.
No.
Darn it.
Now, how many days away is Celebration Anaheim 2015? Once again, that's April 16th through 19th.
386 days away.
Ooh.
As of March the 24th.
Wow.
Now, For some reason, I keep thinking April, next month. Why is this not in my calendar? And then I realized, wait a minute, it's a year.
Yeah.
It's a year and a month away.
It is.
And then a few months after Star Wars Celebration Anaheim, we have our next big convention.
Yes, the D23 Disney Expo.
I'm so glad you didn't say Comic-Con. We're so over Comic-Con.
Yeah, too crowded. Although the D23 Expo gets more crowded every time, but hopefully by then...
But it's manageable. You can walk around.
It is. And hopefully by then the Anaheim Convention Center will be a little bit expanded, actually. So as of March 24th, there are 508 days until the D23 Expo.
And it'll be held the same place as the Star Wars Celebration Convention over at the Anaheim Convention Center.
Yeah. In fact, they finally announced the dates for the D23 Expo, which happens, it occurs every 2 years. It doesn't occur every year. And it's going to return to Anaheim on August 14th through 16th, 2015. Now, it's still only 3 days, a 3-day-long convention, and this convention needs to be 4 days long.
Isn't there a place to write in?
I don't know. There probably is, and there's probably a survey. Like, guess that would be my number one critique. And actually, I was speaking with someone over Twitter who also felt that it really needed to be 4 days, because you just don't have time to go see all the panels you want and then still do the floor.
And then a secondary critique would be, get your act together for the costume contest.
Yeah, that too. But that's another story.
So a few days later, we'll have Star Wars Episode 7. And by a few days later, I mean over 100 days later.
Oh.
Yes. But 2015 is going to be so busy, it'll go by in a blink.
It really will.
So now, backtracking, it is 634 days as of March 24th.
Until Star Wars Episode 7?
Yes.
Woohoo!
Now, there's a lot of news lately about Star Wars Episode 7 that everyone's going crazy about. However, this new news is all old news.
Yeah?
They're talking about the film starting production in May. Didn't we know that months ago?
Yeah, unless that was like a rumor months ago.
No, it was pretty much a given. And then, get this, it'll be taking place 30 years after Return of the Jedi. We already knew that, too.
Did we?
Yeah, that's been That's been out there for a while now. And it's now going to be shot in IMAX, or partially shot in IMAX.
Huh.
And that's one of those things like, well, yeah. Even though J.J. Abrams said he didn't want to shoot in IMAX because it's just so big and clunky. Come on, reality here. You know it's going to be 3D. You know it's going to be shown in IMAX. So, So I'm glad they're putting out all these stories, but these stories are pretty old. I'm just saying.
You can say that, Richard. That's your prerogative. Now, if you're planning on going to Star Wars Weekends or the D23 Expo or Celebration Anaheim and you need a place to stay, well, you can always contact Autumn Barnes at mymickeyvacationtravel.com because she has all the travel deals and can help you book your vacation and help you save money. And if you contact her and mention Skywalking Through Neverland, you can get a special deal. So contact her, mymickeyvacationtravel.com.
So thank you once again for listening to Skywalking Through Neverland. We really appreciate you coming back week after week and giving us your very valuable input.
Yeah, and we love feedback, so send us emails.
Five-star reviews.
Yeah, send us emails.
Five-star reviews.
Yes. So share at skywalkingthroughneverland.com. We got a couple emails from listeners this week, including Peter Heitman, who mentioned that our audio sounded fantastic. Thank you, Peter. And also, five-star reviews. What was that? Someone was saying five-star reviews.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, on iTunes and Stitcher, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there you go. So yes, 5-star reviews, iTunes and Stitcher. And then of course, keep up with us all week on facebook.com/skywalkingthroughneverland and tweet us at skywalkingpod.
Now the more 5-star reviews we get, the higher up on the podcasting list we get. And we're not just here for ourselves, we're here for you too. And we really want to promote the Star Wars and Disney and pop culture fan communities.
Absolutely. So yeah, give us those 5-star reviews and we will give you a shout out on next week's podcast.
So join us next week when we'll have lots of very big surprises that we're working on right now.
Are they such big surprises that we don't know what they are yet?
No, we got some things in the works. We just want to solidify them before announcing them.
Okay. You always have ideas going on in that brain of yours.
I've got the next two shows planned out.
Wow. He's a planner.
And speaking of planning, the one thing you should never plan on,
never land on Alderaan. There you go. That worked.
Okay, we're done. We're out.
I'm sorry. I'm getting punchy. Thank you for listening to Skywalking Through Neverland. Skywalking Through Neverland was created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Segment producers are David Scale, Richard Woloski, Sarah Woloski, and Mark Agushowitz. Graphic design and website design by Sarah Woloski. Technical advisor is Peter Heitman. Skywalking Through Neverland is not affiliated with Lucasfilm Limited, Disneyland Resorts, or the Walt Disney Company. All names, sounds, and related items of Star Wars and Disney are registered, trademarked, and copyright Lucasfilm Limited and the Walt Disney Company and their respective trademark and copyright holders, all rights reserved. Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. All original content of this podcast is the intellectual property of Hey Hey Entertainment, copyright 2013, all rights reserved. No part of this show may be repurposed, reproduced, redistributed, or rebroadcasted without the written permission of Hey Hey Entertainment.
Sorry, all that had to be said.
Goodbye. Live long and prosper. Wait, sorry. May the force be with you.
And cut. That's a wrap.